I think it's day three. That's right. We began this on Wednesday. I hope you folks had a good time last night at the Friendship Garden. A wonderful event with great food, fantastic music, and what a location. But the best of all, that we could all hang out together. So we want to have a very special session here for you this morning. Obviously, times are changing in our world, both technologically, but politically and administratively, how we operate, how we get our funding, what's going on, and what does the future actually hold for us? What are we going to be looking at in the days ahead? And we're very fortunate to have a keynote speaker to open up this plenary this morning. Very well versed in all of these subjects. He's actually the leader of the band. He takes us forward and will move us with great vision and energy. And it's really a pleasure to have with us this morning the president of the Alliance for Community Media, Mr. Michael Wassenaar.
Thank you, Jay. And I want to thank everyone here today. I want to thank ACM West for inviting me to join you in Fresno. And I want to thank the people of Fresno. This has been great. This is the first time I've actually spent time in the community. And you know, the words yesterday from the keynote presentation really resonated with me because everybody is from some place that deserves to be recognized. Nobody is from no place. And was part of the reason why we work in our field is we're telling the stories of those places, the stories of people who very often aren't recognized by dominant media or dominant institutions. So I don't want to say that we're all Fresno, but there's a little part of me that thinks that as I'm here today with you. So I was asked to speak today to talk about the future of community media, and I'm not paid to be a prognosticator. I'm paid to work with organizations across the country that do important work to help change people's lives and build communities and inform citizens about what goes on with their government and help inform people about the choices that they can make in their lives as they're building their families, as they're building their lives and they're building their economies and their communities. So I'd like to focus on that as we think about the future, because I think it's very, very hard in the times that we're in to be thinking precisely about what will be happening tomorrow, let alone 10 years from now or 20 years from now. But I think there are some keys that we can concentrate on as we're thinking about making sure that we are resilient and we endure well into the next decade and beyond. So, if I can make this work, let's talk about the weather. This is something that binds us all together. Maybe it's because I'm a Minnesotan. You know, weather is something that changes in every day. I think it was back in D.C. it was 70 degrees yesterday, and it's snowing this morning. So I think weather is the thing that binds us all together. But at the same time, it's the thing that no one can do anything about. Everyone talks and talks and talks, but nobody does anything, right? But I think weather can also present an interesting metaphor for the conditions you find yourself in. As you're trying to make your way in the world. And I think certainly it's a common issue for all of us in terms of a specific issue that I want to be talking about today that I think acts as a metaphor for our lives in the future. So, let's talk about the weather. Are we going to be experiencing headwinds or tornadoes in the next 10 years? Is that my phone? I think my phone is making... Chris, could you actually turn my phone off? Damn technology. I'm not unavailable to talk right now. Will we be facing headwinds that will make our lives difficult, or will we be looking at disruptive change that will actually change the landscape around us? So let's talk about possibilities for factors that will affect your work in the course of, I would say, not just the next 10 years, but in the next 10 months. So the first thing is media trends and habits for audiences that we work with. Increasingly, we know that we work with fractured and fractioned audiences that work on multiple platforms, multiple devices, and have their information stream managed in different ways. It's been ever thus. I mean, I think I have to remind everybody that radio disrupted the newspaper industry, television disrupted the radio industry, the internet disrupted television, and I think the things to come will disrupt the internet, right? And it's not said that we simply gave up using radio when TV went along. Actually, as long as we live in a literate society, and maybe that's a battle that we have to be engaged in, that, you know, literacy in your community is actually a positive good for the economy and for the work that you do. You have to care about it, because if we're, it's kind of frightening to think that we could be living in a soon post-literate society, right? So I would suggest to you that if you care about democracy, you need to care about literacy and edumacation, yeah? Right? But people build meaning through many different media forms that they use, whether it be the newsletters that are pasted up on the laundromat bulletin board or the feed that they get on their phone. Okay, we build meaning in many different ways. So as you're thinking about the ways in which you're building meaning and community, and also you're teaching people to communicate, to be able to effectively build community and to tell their stories, I would still keep hammering away on the idea that you have to be talking about multiple communication forms. And while I love the television studios that I see across the country that people invest in, I would simply ask to be recognized that you are not a television studio, that you are communication educators, and you need to be giving people tools, not a tool, for communication. I think a useful metaphor here is when you work in the hammer factory, every problem looks like a nail. Yeah? Right? And, you know, I mean, I used to do a lot of interviews in Madison, Wisconsin, and I would have the guys from the National Organization to Reform Marijuana Laws on regularly to talk about any number of issues, because it turned out that all issues in the world would be solved by, you know, regularizing and legalizing marijuana. It actually was like this one of these things that, you know, it's like, you know, some political parties and cutting taxes. It's like other people with prayer. It was like cutting, you know, normalizing marijuana would actually solve all the problems from child prostitution to dog walking issues. I mean, it was quite amazing. But anyway, if you work in the hammer factory, every problem looks like a nail. Yeah? So if the mission of your work is to help people communicate using tools, I would suggest you need to be thinking about the toolbox that you're building in this sort of multivariable world of people's communication. And I know that many people are very skilled in terms of creating television, and I appreciate that. But there's a real reason why people are thinking about building radio stations to partner with television stations, that people are thinking about other forms of media communication that they can be teaching, and also that they're thinking about teaching literacy so that you have an educated populace to actually communicate with, to build common understandings in communities. And I would suggest to you that that's part of our work. So that's a, I don't know if it's a headwind or a tornado, I think that will be a constant presence that we see. The next thing I would say is we have an ever-shortening attention economy in the world. More and more of our economic vision is short-term thinking, short-term horizons, quarterly reports, but even further within media, it's about the clicks you generate with the stupid headlines that someone generates. I mean, how many times have you seen the headline that says, well, you'll never believe what Angelina Jolie ate this morning? And then this happened. Oh, what happened? Click. Someone gets paid when you click. And the problem actually with fake news isn't that there are mendacious people out to create false stories to mislead you. That's been the case forever in this world. Actually, there are people who will want to mislead you for money, believe it or not. The problem is you now have media systems that are based upon the idea that getting your attention is worth paying somebody else money because an advertising dollar is at stake. So there's no algorithm within online news distribution, either in Facebook or any other system, that's about veracity, truthfulness, or the public good. Those aren't built into those systems. It's about making money for advertisers. And that's the reason why we can be driven off a cliff with fake news. It's because the people who are creating content are doing so simply to make a buck. and who knows where they are. It actually turns out in the case of the 2016 elections, a lot of them were in the former Yugoslavia Republic of Macedonia, being paid to generate content by, I don't know, somebody who's in the Soviet Union, I mean, Russia, right? So, just saying. Anyway, that is not their issue. They're taking advantage of what is an attention economy that I think is running afoul of other public good. I think we're also developing a profoundly anti-local economy. I think that is actually part of the, you know, part of the response we saw in America during the course of the 2016 elections, is either an unconscious or a conscious response to much of the economy being based on production of things elsewhere for local consumption. Whether it be the cantaloupe we ate this morning here, I love the facility, don't get me wrong, I'm not downing the cantaloupe, but it wasn't grown in Fresno. Yeah? I don't, Jerry can't attest to this, but my guess is it wasn't grown in Fresno. Not at this time of year, right? And again, as a Minnesotan, I know that I can't get fruits and vegetables that are grown natively during the course of at least 12 months, no, 8 months. Anyway, a whole bunch of the year. More and more of our economy is not about products and services that are delivered locally. And from a media standpoint, actually, you're seeing something that maps on very nicely onto the concept of food deserts in America, and that's media deserts, news deserts, where there is no local content generation. That everything you see about your culture in mediated forms of communication is from someplace else. It's not about you. And actually, that's one of the things I think I found so heartening about, you know, the stories I've been hearing about CMAQ here in Fresno, and I know it's true for many of our colleagues here in California, in Hawaii, across the country. It's the reason, I think, why you're devoted to localism, and localism has to be a key value that you're supporting, is because you're fighting a headwind of media that's from somewhere else that's profoundly alienating to people. When you wake up every morning and everything you see on the television is not about you, it gives you the sense that you are an object, not a subject. Right? And at our core, we have to be recognizing that everybody is a valuable person. Everybody has a valuable story of meaning. Everybody is the subject of their own story. And our media system does not recognize that. Period. End of story. It's not built on that. And it's our mission, I think, to inculcate that in our communities. That's a strong headwind that you're going to be facing. Here's some tornadoes. The political and regulatory environment reinforces those very issues that I'm talking about, where communities don't matter, in some case, property rights don't matter. So actually, that's part of the fight that's going on in Washington, D.C. right now about whether or not communities can control the rights of way and whether or not citizens actually have the ability to say no when a corporation wants something in their backyard. Right? I don't think, at least in the next 4 years, we will see a positive regulatory environment in Washington, D.C. My guess is that it will be just as pernicious as it has been in many states about local community needs. And we will probably see media consolidation of vast scale over the course of the next 4 years. I would really not be surprised if you see two or three wireless providers merging with the cable industry. Look for it. And if you think the cable industry can be hard to work with, you haven't worked with the wireless industry, because they control the regulatory process in most states. Okay? So just, I think that's a tornado. Could be a headwind. I think that's a tornado. I'm being really positive here this morning. Everyone's, come on, everybody. And then I think the other tornado that we really probably need to be thinking about, and I think it sort of demands some consideration, even though I won't talk about it in great depth today, is what the effect of future technologies will have on our economies, on our media system, and on the nature of work in our modern world. There's some really sort of amazing estimates about what how many jobs will remain in the United States in the next 20 years. Because it turns out that people are not crossing the border for your jobs. Robots are being built for your jobs. And that's going to be the nature of work in America in the next 20 years. It will be artificially intelligence assisted, robot assisted, much more computer inculcated, if you will, in terms of many, many, many forms of work. As we look at ubiquitous computing, the rise of the Internet of Things across an America where actually Americans can afford it. I think there has to be this large gap of economies of hyper-connected Americans and under-connected Americans, if you will. So I think that's going to be a challenge that we look at. But, you know, among the ideas to be looking at with future technology will be artificial intelligence. It will probably have benefits for us, particularly I think some economies will occur that I think will really vastly change the work that we do in community media. I'm really looking forward to better speech-to-text recognition, which is, I think, an area that will be rapidly growing over the course of the next five years, not 20. And that has a potential impact for expanding the possible impact that you could be having for significant communities that you work with that have disabilities that can't use your programming fully now. So I think there's a great deal of potential there. I think there's a great deal of disruption that'll occur as well. Obviously, content created by robots you should be considering. It turns out that one of the jobs that probably will be disappearing in America in the next 20 years will be journalists. That's disturbing. Why is that? Well, it turns out that you can predict content behavior pretty easily with very powerful computers. Now, why would you do that? Well, because it's a lot more economical to build a computer than to pay a person over time. And you can just meet the needs of people by creating content. The thing that's frightening, actually, and I'm not going to talk about this too much, I think it has some deep implications for our notion of retinal truth. For over 200 years, the idea of seeing something through a camera lens meant that you were seeing the truth. That, I think, will change in the next 20 years. As we become untethered from reality, welcome. And then the last thing I'd say is ubiquitous video and surveillance will be, I think, dominant issues in the developed world in the next 20 years. 3D printing of micro cameras that you can distribute through the air. Someone's actually doing that right now. They're actually looking at ways to find like little nanobots that you can't see, that you simply distribute in the air to be able to get video imagery and audio. Why do that? Well, because you can. No, actually, it's because it would be a very, very easy way to be able to have ubiquitous surveillance. And actually to predict your behaviors as a consumer. Because we all know when the Declaration of Independence was written in 1776, your rights to consume were being fought for, right? Yeah? I don't know. One of the most frightening moments I had in Austin, Texas, besides dancing with my Natoa brethren at the bar at 2 a.m., was hearing a presentation at South by Southwest a couple of years ago about the wonders of building a frictionless economy, meaning that once we can find a way to be able to get at people's money so that they don't have to have human agency for their decisions, profits will abound. Neat. Yeah? I just hate to say this, but the profit incentive that's driving much technological change has fundamental implications for our ability to act as citizens in our communities. I think that's a tornado ahead. Okay? So what do you do about the weather when it's changing? I would also say that because I've moved from a landlocked state to Maryland, and I now live in a semi-coastal community, and I visit more coastal communities now in my work. I start thinking about weather a great deal, much more than I did as a Minnesotan, because of the profound effects of climate change. And I think that's another metaphor that we can be using for thinking about ways in which our communities react to profound change that we actually might not be in full control of, right? So, I don't know if you can dim the lights here. I don't know if they're going to hurt the video at all, but how do you react to profound change? That's Miami Beach. And that's not a simulation. That was December when they had a king tide. And basically, you know, you get a couple inches of rain. And I don't know if you can see that, but the water doesn't go anywhere. That basically goes up. And because it's at sea level, Miami Beach is inundated. And yet they're still building towers on that strip of sand. Or maybe Chinese investors are building strips of towers on that strip of sand. But there's a community that's been there for multiple generations that is asking the question of what happens as the waters rise and the conditions they find themselves change, and the lives that they lead are still valuable, are still meaningful. They don't want to give up their history and their culture, but they may not be in total control. And I think actually that's a condition many of us find ourselves in our lives. And it goes beyond our work in community media. It goes in our work in day-to-day in communities, rich and poor, large and small. There are things that happen every day that you're not in control of. So, you know, within the Miami context, they're thinking of a couple things. I mean, obviously abatement is one way to be able to get the issue. Actually, you know, finding ways to have a carbonless economy means that in like 50 years, your community could look different. And if you don't do something about that, you know, the community may disappear. So abatement's necessary. But until you have the ability to abate a condition, you have to be thinking about resilience, adaptability, the ability to be able to create conditions for meaning when conditions are changing around you. And actually that's the civic discussion that's happening in Miami right now. You know, they're talking about how you build resilient communities so that their culture and their history can continue, because they may not be in control of the abatement issues that are necessary so that their city exists in 100 years. I live in Silver Spring, Maryland. I will be not a semi-coastal community. I will be on the coast if I'm still alive in 50 years. Right? And I think this is sort of a frightening prospect that people are beginning to see in terms of radical climate change. But I think as we think about our work in community media and we think about the headwinds and the tornadoes to come, we need to be thinking about the ways in which we build resiliency into our organizations. Because if your mission is important today, my suggestion is your mission is important tomorrow, and you have to find a way for it to endure. Otherwise, it's just been a fun gig. And now I'm off to do something else. All right? I believe that our missions are important. I hope you do. But I think it's sort of a question I think that organizations have to be asking themselves, is how exactly you can build resiliency in your organization to sustain yourself over time as conditions change in our economy, within our regulatory structure, and even, you know, within the way people use media. So let me provide a couple suggestions. So my questions are for you right now. This is probably questions you should ask yourself and your organization. Maybe talk to your board about this. Are you resilient or are you fragile? If something were to happen, would your organization break? Or do you have bounce back ability, as they say in the NBA or the NFL at the combine? Do you have the ability to bounce back from a catastrophic tragedy that occurs? When the asteroid hits, are you T-Rex? Big, brilliant, mega predator with itty bitty arms that toppled over when the conditions changed, had no ability to be able to eat herbivorous diets, right? You know, and when the food chain died, it died. Or you're the capacious squirrel that evolves into something else. Actually evolves into us, right? It's a different metaphor, a different talk, sorry about that. So are you resilient or are you fragile? And then how do you create adaptability and sustainability for your work to endure? Okay? You may have a well-oiled machine right now, but it could be a Model T. Or you could be a farrier, you could do really good horseshoe work. You could be an excellent craftsman at horseshoes. The job market changed around 1910. So I want to give you a couple of thoughts about adaptability to think about within your organizations. And we can argue about them, but I think they're good rules of the road to think about as you're trying to build sustainability in the organization. So the first rule I would have you think about is the 30-70 rule. And I don't know if anyone can read that with the lighting, but it's that no single source of revenue amounts to more than 30% of the gross revenues of your organization. Let me say that again. No single source of revenue amounts to more than 30% of the gross revenues of your organization. That means you need to learn division, Sean. I understand. So, I think that's a key question for many of our organizations, that they have single source contracts with local government. Because you have one source of revenue. And in some instances, you're prevented by the contract from raising other revenues. That's actually a recipe for instability. And that's a recipe to have the organization die. You know, the old saying is when the dog gets sick, the flea gets the flu. I mean, that happened with many of our organizations in the last 15 years as local governments went through ups and downs in terms of their economic conditions, separate from all the state franchising issues that occurred across the country. If you're hyper-dependent upon one source of revenue, you are subject to all of the ups and downs of the super client, all of the whims and bagatelles, all of the problems that can occur. Now, you could diversify your revenue. Let's say you're not working with one local government, you're working with multiple local governments. That probably spreads the risk over time, right? So you're less dependent. And further, you could be thinking about different sources and sectors of the local economy to be gaining revenue. But I think that 30-70 principle maintains in either sense, so that if something catastrophic occurred, you survive and the mission survives. Your programs may change. You may not be doing the same thing. You may not be able to use the same tool in the community media toolbox, but you'll still have the toolbox, right? So, here, we're talking about earned income strategies as potential diversification, donated income strategies, thinking about donations either from granting agencies and philanthropic agencies. Individuals certainly are a key part of that work. But in all instances, we're talking about new program development, it seems to me. And I strongly suggest that you need to be thinking about creating programs that have multiple funding streams or diversifying funder streams for the entire organization. I've had many painful conversations with organizations that are looking at impending loss of funding, and they want to know ways to get money for what I do now or what I did yesterday. And I think it's very, very hard to be able to backfill that. And in many instances, the activities that you were doing were not meant to be revenue-earning activities. I mean, you think about the public access model in America. It was not meant to be a revenue-generating activity. It was meant to be a utility. It's a utility model. Open to all, right? That's not about revenue generation in a nonprofit world. It's just not. So I think it means some changing notions of how we do our work. The other thing I would have you think about is the 25-75 rule. And I think this is something that is easier to get than that 30-70 rule. 25-75 means that 25% of your expenditures should be on the furtherance of your mission, not on your program costs. And when I say program, I don't mean the television show you create. I mean the things that you do that affect the world. So what am I talking about there? Well, I'm talking about governance, external communications, fund development, lobbying and public relations, research and development. Who does research and development in this room? Okay. Everybody should be doing research and development. Yeah? General administration and HR. Okay. When I was running an organization, I did one, two, three, four, five. I had five of those six covered. And I kept on trying to build capacity so I could have all six. Okay. For many of our organizations, they maybe have two things covered. They maybe have general administration and HR, and maybe have governance covered. A lot of you are finding ways to have external communications built into your regular work. And bravo, you need to be justifying that in your budgets and talking about that with boards and with government agencies about the necessity of building external communications to be able to further the mission of the organization and the success of your programs. You need to be thinking about fund development if you're a nonprofit. And that's a full-time job for any organization, actually. So the thing that I think is kind of astounding is when you look at our industry, I think I can count on one hand the number of development directors that exist. And that's simply wrong. Just simply wrong. It has to change. And we have to be teaching people how to do fundraising. And actually, I would say that the leadership, and it's not our fault, the leadership that we've built within our systems doesn't know how to do fundraising. That was not it was on a screen in the hiring process that we used for leadership activity. So why do you expect that we fail at some things? It's because we didn't have those skills to begin with. It's like asking the pole vaulter to run a marathon because the race changed halfway. Pole vaulters don't race. That's a mixed metaphor. Sorry about that. Lobbying and public relations. Now, as ACM members, I do a lot of that work for you, but you need to be doing that work for yourself as well. I mean, certainly I think a lot of our organization's leadership will do that in terms of work with county and local government, but you need to be, you know, building that in as a regular function within the furtherance of your mission. And I would just say the research and development thing is, it needs to happen systematically in every local organization. And I'm not meaning that you've got, like, you know, Beaker in the test tube or that you've got John Hauser in a closet somewhere. It's a great product. It's a little mini John Hauser. It comes out. No, anyway. But what I'm saying is that if you have enough slack within your organization to be able to test ideas, try them out with potential clients and audiences, determine whether or not they're successes or failures, you've got the ability to take more risk and to adapt to changing conditions. The problem that we have, I think, in most of our organizations is there's not enough slack, there's not enough extra leeway to be able to take a risk. And if you have one poker chip, one excess poker chip to risk on a thing, you know, which, do you put it on red or black? Which part of the roulette wheel do you put it on? It's frightening. And I see that in organizations all across the country. They don't know exactly how to take risks because they don't have the ability to lose. Right? So we need to build in excess capacity within our budgets to be able to experiment. Yeah? So the question I have to ask before we kind of open up for discussions here in the next 5 minutes or so is, do you want to do that? I mean, you could just, you know, move to Hawaii and watch Alelo. I don't know. You could, you know, I mean, I think it's a question that all of us as leaders have to ask ourselves is, do we have the ability to build resiliency into our organizations and to ask our colleagues to learn to adapt, change, and grow? I think that's going to be the fundamental challenge that we have in the next 10 years. If we want to endure, we have to recruit, train people who will lead the work in the next generation. Okay? And I'm not talking about getting a new camera operator. Yeah? Not. I'm not even talking about, you know, having someone who's good wrapping cords, although that is a skill that, you know, if the robots take that skill away, I don't know what I'm going to do. The over-under technique with the cord wrapping. I mean, if we have to do that, get done away with that. I mean, but I think what it means is you're building leaders who can adapt, change, and build things in a profoundly changing environment, who can take a mission and experiment to be able to find ways to be able to create things that are successful in our communities, that are meaningful in our communities, that connect with people at the heart and in the head. Right? And I really want to suggest to you that what we're going to be engaged in is an exercise in adaptive leadership. That's actually a field where the challenge as a leader is not to get the damn answer right. If you just teach people to give you the right answer, you could be teaching monkeys to type. Okay? And adaptive leadership is about asking people to learn to be able to make decisions on their own and be leaders themselves. And we need that DNA spread throughout our organizations. It's not about getting it right. It's about building adaptability and leadership throughout an organization so that people know first that they're in control of their destiny. I mean, that's the other thing that happens in these types of environments I'm talking about. If you have no sense of control, guess what ends up happening in any organization, big or small, for-profit or non-profit? It's the number one factor leading to burnout and HR turnover, is you have no sense of control over your life at work. You have no sense of control of your life at all. You have no sense of surety about the future in terms of what you're building for your family, right? We need to be building the confidence amongst our staffs, amongst our colleagues, that they have the ability to adapt, change, and lead in what could be a profoundly changed environment. So let me just kind of leave you with some other things I'm thinking about in terms of what I expect to be seeing in the next couple of years in response to these kind of conditions. The first is we'll probably be seeing greater partnerships with other community-based learning professions, because you're educators, yes? Do you identify as an educator? I think that's probably a question you should be asking yourself in the work that you do every day. But you should be devoted to building literacies, citizenship, creative enterprise, and economic development at the local level. Those are all, I think, creative areas that we can be doing profound things in the next decade. We'll, I think, be seeing greater content creation and curation on multiple platforms. You're already working toward multiple platform distribution. Actually, a number of our vendors today and during the course of the conference have been talking about multi-platform distribution. But I would suggest to you that you can't just be a distribution platform for other people's content. You have to be finding ways to be able to engaging other people to specifically create content or create and curate content yourself. And I think that will be a profound change for many of our organizations that have never had any history of editorial control, particularly because of the question of whether or not you're providing a First Amendment platform and it's an open access model. But I would suggest to you that if you're thinking about program development models that may not be related to that First Amendment platform, may not be related to that public access platform, program development models that deal with local content curation and local content creation actually I think are very fundable in this environment. It's the reason why I think a lot of people are looking at news projects across the country. As we look at the diminution of useful information in local communities. We'll see more sophisticated organizational models, for-profit, non-profit, for societal benefit organizations. I think one of the things I was really inspired by is, you know, hearing Jerry talk about the ways in which they have sort of collaborative contract structures here in Fresno to help sustain the organization. Those types of organizational models, I think we have to be creative with to be able to find ways to be able to, you know, have flexibility to be able to do our mission. You know, the work that Akaku did years ago in terms of its economic development model with its building, I think is also another sort of a very interesting question. But I think there's like lots of ways we could be thinking about this in terms of for societal benefit organizations. Merged entities and co-ops, I think, will occur. I think in many rural areas or semi-rural areas, I think it's going to be very, very hard to sustain labor force to be able to endure. So I think that means the possibility of merger occurring. So that means you actually have to learn to take the time to be able to have that discussion in the first place. Right? And then I think the other thing I would just sort of have you think about is the power that you have in terms of making community and convening ideas within a locale. I think it's a unique thing that you have to be able to create community in the sense of the place in our minds where we share ideas together that are significant for each of us. I can tell you actually that as communities are trying to figure out where they're going in the future, you have a place in being the indispensable convening partner to bring people together to have civic discussion that's meaningful, to help find ways to be able to solve problems together as you bring people together. You know, and thinking about yesterday's presentation from the former mayor of Fresno, you know, a local community needs to have a place where you are hashing out your identity, where you're talking about problems, and you're talking about them together, and that emboldens people to be a part of an active partner in our democracy. So I just suggest to you that that's an area that you need to be thinking about going in whole hog, if you will. Okay. So I know that's a lot. Let's talk about it. There's a little time right now here today. And I'm happy to, you know, I'm here throughout the day today, and then, you know, that's actually my contact information, and that's my leash, my cell phone. So if you want to call me at any point, you can. And it's just like a little choker chain. It's like, oh, hello. So I'd love to kind of continue the conversation with you, but let's talk about where we're going to go in our complex future because, you know, again, like the weather, it's going to affect all of us. But I think we can do something about it. So anyway, thank you. I'm happy to take questions or discussions, or if someone just wants to tell me I'm full of it, I'm happy to hear that as well. Mike Johnson.
Center in the United States, and that possibly this is repeated at the national conference, because you just hit it right on the head. I mean, grand slam, out of the ballpark. Everything you said is absolutely right. And so I just hope that this little group here, you know, takes all this home with them or back to work, because this is very, very enlightening, but very, very true. And so I just hope you share this with others, and so this just doesn't get lost, because you have to continue this speech again and again until it sinks in. So thank you very much.
You're welcome. Well, you're welcome, Annette. And we were recording this, right? It was on? It was on? Okay. Yeah. Okay. Sean.
Like you wanted to keep cable wrapping for humans, but maybe we're okay with governance going to robots.
No, that wasn't really a
question, but I'm just curious about the new model, the organizational model.
Yeah.
Particularly, do we see any co-ops out there?
No.
We see indie media sort of.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that. I mean, so there are successful models for media arts organizations around the country. I think it's one of the reasons I'm really kind of excited about seeing what's happening with the progression of what was Portland Community Media and is now Open Signal Media in Portland, Oregon. Now, that's interesting in a couple of ways. One, Portland has a very, very supportive local governments for community media operations. They do great work, and they're very forward-thinking. Second, the Portland government is interested in digital literacy and economic empowerment as a framework for that work, and they're challenging the local community media makers to be thinking about their work within that frame as well as the speech frame, right? Digital inclusion plans, and also sort of, you know, creating significant programming that meets community needs. Because frankly, nothing's being done on that score by other institutions. And then the third thing I think it's curious is that they come, you know, the leadership there came from a media arts organization that was running a community theater, right? And he's taken his staff from the theater and he's grafted them onto the staff of the media organization.
Rural thing, that would be the Grange Hall,
I mean, and I think there's some other things to be thinking about here. One, I think there's probably some possibilities, especially if we have appropriate broadband, of being able to have more cooperation between rural and urban or semi-urban organizations as we create content or as we work together, right? I mean, I think that's an area. I mean, I saw this when I was in Minnesota. Is that, you know, we worked with rural PBS stations to be able to create content in the state capital because they couldn't afford to be able, they didn't have the mechanisms and the money to be able to you know, have like studio rental at the state capital. But we had the ability to be able to partner with them to create content that supported both institutions and actually informed Minnesotans. The program still is going on today. So, you know, I think there's lots of possibilities for that sort of, you know, sort of building complementarity. I think it also means that we have to be learning about different types of models, whether you're, you know, learning about sort of co-op structures or you're learning about, I mean, I think an emerging area that is growing in some states is societal benefit organizations, right? Which is like a form of a limited liability partnership for societal benefit. So I think there's a lot to learn and grow, but it speaks to the idea that we have to be able to nurture ourselves, and we have to be able to have the time to do it, and we have to be able to build the excess capacity within our organizations to be able to study these things, and to adapt even successful models that other people give us. Within the national organization, we're going to be trying to show those exemplars of things that you could be doing, but you know, I can't take the time to change your organization, so we have to build that local capacity. Oh, come on. Deb.
So, you know, we're kind of the new kids on the block in terms of public access. And for those that don't know, we are a new model.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we are a model where arts councils are the first two arts councils in the state of California to run public access television. And it's been a really interesting journey. So complementary to each other. It's increased our ability to get grants because we have a documentation process.
Mm-hmm.
We've been building all of that documentation process into everything that we do. So all of our programming now is being driven by the documentarian kind of approach.
Right.
So whether it's working with at-risk youth, training them, working with an aging population, creating programming, started a 530 media project with our local newspaper, and training people on Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, training them on just about anything they want to know. We ask them, what do you want to learn? And 530 just stands for our area code.
Mm.
Okay, so it's
right.
The 530 media project. And then we did a democracy pop-up with our local
newspaper.
So I just have to say, if there's like a project you want to try on for size, doing like a media pop-up studio or a pop-up installation in what is like essentially a vacant space where you're creating art, media, and building community to be able to underline an issue or work with significant populations that need to have social connection with others in the community is a great project to do. Then there's lots of examples of this sort of stuff being happening around the country in big urban centers and small communities. I think the other thing I would say, Deb, is that we need to document that journey that you're on so that we can do two things. So that we can have your colleagues from within the community media field learn about those practices and see whether or not we have the ability to grow those practices at our sites. But two, we need to be evangelists back out to art councils across the country, because I think there's something that's probably possible in many different communities. It's a similar discussion that should be happening, and it's not happening enough within the libraries, frankly, is the partnerships that we can build within libraries, the allies that we have within libraries, and then, you know, whether or not it's a partnership program or it's a full-on operation model, you know. Great.
I agree. It's libraries, arts councils, media centers, there's just such great synergy there, and it would be awesome if we could begin to look at those structurally, because it makes for a much stronger organization. Just, you know, your 70-30 model up there, that begins to change when you get grant funding and other types of contracts in place.
Right.
And so I just think it's super important for our local organizations to.
Well, one of the things I can commit to you all is that, you know, within the national organization, we want to be telling those stories more clearly. So having the better documentation and sharing of those success stories is something that we're committed to. Primarily, I think, probably through the foundation, because the ACM Foundation will be looking to try and find ways to be able to talk about great things that we can be promoting across the country.
I want to throw out two more ideas.
Yeah.
Another really open area is the juvenile justice. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of work going on with juvenile justice systems, and we just started a program with our local MLK center where the kids are being sentenced by peer court. I don't know if other communities may have peer court where peers actually sentence their peers to different things, and they're being sentenced to our digital media classes. And they learn to tell stories about nonprofit organizations in the community and how those organizations serve the community. So it's a really cool synergistic thing. It's our first, we're only about 4 weeks into this, but we are working with our local Parks and Rec department and the juvenile justice system. And then another project that we're doing is working with the homeless population and documenting and telling stories in the homeless population through an arts project. And that's working with our public health department.
Right.
So there's pots of money out there that you can get, and we have these fabulous tools to document this process, and that's what they're interested in, because everybody wants media. They want content.
Yeah, and I just would just sort of underline this, is that there are probably multiple possible partners that you could have within a local jurisdiction. And Minnesota is probably a special case, but when I was working in St. Paul, I worked with local government, county government, state government, multi-county government, and the federal government.
Yikes.
Right? Yeah. And so, you know, I had contracted work in all five of those levels, right? And again, that's a diversification tactic to be able to grow your mission. Just to be really clear about that.
Yeah.
It wasn't just because, oh, I want money.
Right.
It was a way for us to be able to diversify our practices and be more stable.
And the more partners you have, the more stable you are, and they start to take on the work, and then you find that they're bringing people in that want to learn, and so then you have more volunteers and everything.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Sue, go ahead.
One of the things I wanted to point out this afternoon, the very examples you pointed out with regard to Akaku and with regard to CMAC and how those funding structures work, there's a workshop on that this afternoon. I just want to make sure everybody is aware of it, and we put this particular workshop together specifically because we wanted to encourage people to start to look at how they can diversify their revenue sources, grow their partnerships, because a lot of what Deborah's talking about, a lot of what I see happening around the country, is taking the people that sometimes we work with or we would like to work with, but looking at how we work with them in a different way, okay? And this morning, yesterday, we had people from Hands On to Central California, who's an organization who works with nonprofits. It was all about how to nurture membership, how to build volunteerism, and how to build partnerships. And so much of what we're talking about here, and what you've been talking about, is being strategic, thinking ahead, giving yourself the flexibility to try things. I mean, try things that maybe you wouldn't have otherwise tried. One of the distressing trends I see here, particularly in the state of California, as funds have become more and more stressed for a whole variety of reasons, a lot of community media centers have merged, have dropped more and more of the things that they did that were community-oriented and focused almost strictly on doing meeting coverage for the local government. And it is going exactly the opposite direction in some ways of what we need to be going. We need to be covering, we need to be partnering with our local governments, but we cannot be relying wholeheartedly on that money to survive, or we will not survive, because the next time there's a recession, there's next time there's a crunch, it's not going to exist.
And I would just point out one other issue. One other issue here is that you may think that governments are well-funded, but there's an entire lobby that basically wants to get rid of local government. I just want to be clear about that.
Yeah, but what I'm simply saying here is that there is a trend going that direction, and it is distressing. And it's exactly the opposite of what we've been talking about, the direction we want to talk about going to have sustainability, to have long-term legs, and to make sure that we're serving our entire community in a way that is really empowering them, and it's about civic engagement and growth.
And I feel very sympathetic for many of my colleagues that work with G channels across the country, because it can be difficult if you don't have the revenue flexibility.
Oh, I know.
Right? It can be very, very difficult, because basically, even though you have money, it's a little bit like golden handcuffs. Mm-hmm. And you have to do the thing you did because you did the thing you did.
And that's very often the way the government process works.
And so it's good in one sense, but it's debilitating in the other sense of being able to generate ideas and generate partnership. It can be hard from within that government structure. So we need to be thoughtful about how those structures build more and build more meaning. You know, I know that there will be people will say, well, what's the answer? What's the thing we have to do? It's like, I can't tell you the one thing. I can give you the range of things that succeed in different conditions. And you have to determine whether or not those conditions pertain in your local forecast. If I can keep using my metaphor here.
But all I'm saying is I was not being critical. I was simply saying we have to think about these things ahead of time. Yeah. We have to plan. We have to figure out ways
The other thing I'd say, too, though, is that panic does not induce strategy. and partly that's because of sort of, you know, the evolutionary legacy of our lizard brains. If we're just in panic and fight and flight response, you don't make good decisions. And actually, I've seen some conversations that are actually not very kind of toxic, that go between a super client and a community access center, where the super client says, "Oh, I need you to evolve. I'll cut off your leg. I'll give you 40% less money because that will induce growth." That's what the Soviets did. It doesn't work. You know, if you know biology, that just does not work.
If you're a lizard, it does.
I mean, Soviet biology didn't work, okay? So, I mean, that's not how change occurs. A change occurs in a different place. It doesn't occur in a place of panic. It doesn't occur in a place of stress.
Mike, I just want to ask, first of all, thank you for ACM's participation with the Schools, Health, Libraries, Broadband Coalition.
Yeah, we've just become members of Shelby. Yeah,
and right. I think that you sort of mentioned the broadband piece, but I think it's maybe worth a note that the infrastructure of how people connect, and we obviously see that besides the industry evolving and taking over more and more, the technology does, and so broadband and the availability of broadband and engaging with that in your local community for us has been a really important strategy. But the particular piece about Shelby, the Schools, Health, Libraries, Broadband Coalition, is it reminds us to brand ourselves locally as a community anchor institution.
Yeah.
I mean, you've got, I mean, we talk about it. I mean, it's sort of like this came up through the broadband funding, the ARA, the, you know, broadband stimulus funding, and Shelby was successful at getting this sort of category evolved into the legislation that said community anchor institutions are priority and sort of because they're a local investment that a community makes, the funding programs want to leverage, maybe take them over. I don't mean that there's good and bad mm-hmm. about it, but I think this self-branding as a community anchor institution for the sustainable and durability piece, you mentioned libraries. For us, this has been gold mine. We have the county yep. librarian on our board. I have the dean of the library there, and they're one of our sweetest partners philosophically. They're
I mean, I'd also make the suggestion that we may find in 20 years that librarians are in this room.
Yeah,
because I think that they actually may become key community media practitioners in various settings. So I don't discount that, actually, as our institutions change. But I appreciate you mentioning Shelby, and we're actually, I think that's going to be a partnership that we want to continue for years to come. Matt.
What I would just say, since I know there's a little feeling of like, oh, a lot of weight, with what you're saying, you know, a little, oh, how do we get there? There are a lot of models that we can look at. You know, there's, you know, BVAC, you know, with San Francisco Commons has overhead built in with a larger organization, Brick Arts. Yep. You know, there's models like that to look at. There's the Arts Council kind of models to look at. There's also, you know, we don't talk about this much, but if there's a number of centers in a geographic area, there's nothing that prevents us from eventually talking and saying, should we merge into a tri-county
right.
organization and have satellite offices and share some of those major overhead costs, or just simple sharing of staffing in some areas where they're employed between multiple centers. You know, so there's a lot we can look at, and I would just use your analogy to say, you know, you can't take off without a headwind, so we just need the good design to hit that headwind appropriately and take off for the future flight.
Your ailerons have to be okay. Your ailerons have to be okay. That's right. That's exactly right. I think the most important thing about what you're saying, Matt, that I'm hearing, is that you can't be facing these things in fear, right? Because fear is paralyzing. And, you know, we have to be thinking of ourselves as a civic institution like any other in America. And other nonprofits deal with this stuff all the time, right? And so we have colleagues in our communities who can be founts of information. We've got colleagues across the country that can help. But then I would say that you've got comrades in arms who are probably closer in their work than you think. I mean, you know, the entire idea that, you know, you look at what art museums are doing with media. That actually might be a very, 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 very good model within some communities. That's the thing that Brick has done in Brooklyn. So I really want to applaud what you're saying, Matt. Autumn.
I just want to tag on to what you just said. I'm from Davis, California, and I've been putting a lot of time lately into a kind of new arts coalition in Davis, Arts Alliance Davis. Started about 9 months ago and has really gained traction. When I was first asked to attend, it was kind of like, oh, another thing to go to, and I'm so glad I put the time in because, A, we're partnering with a local museum to do a Friday night after dark media arts thing in about 6 months. Mm-hmm. Bands, food, music at a time when they're usually closed. And secondly, the city just wrote us into a major arts grant for $15,000 in production services. And it wouldn't have come about if I hadn't been going to those meetings and putting the time in. We're gonna be talking about coalition building at the 10:30 session.
Yeah.
And it's just one of the examples. You have to show up.
Have to
do that work.
Have to show up. That is I can't tell you, I mean, that's what life is, right?
Right.
You have to be showing up in things.
Right.
Even when there may not be a particular get from that meeting.
Right.
You know, building the long-term alliance within your community, being a part of your community,
and
is the value that you're providing, because then you're actually being seen as a leader.
Right, and at first people were, you know, a couple people were like, well, media, arts, what, you know, what's the connection? And I've been able to make the case very naturally that what we do is we, you know, aggregate content. Mm-hmm. We not only produce content, but we aggregate. And so we've had all these people from the Alliance coming in and doing programming and going out to their events and doing programming. It's been a great fit.
Very cool. Very, very cool. Go ahead. And tell me your name. I don't think we've met.
We haven't. I feel like an advanced five. My name is Mark Royce. I'm with Fresno Pacific University as a media producer for the marketing and communications team. And I came here for two reasons. One, there was some tech vendors that I wanted to connect with about some things we're doing, and I want to get some help with that. And then I also wanted to investigate CMAC and kind of figure out maybe some collaborative opportunities that there might be between the university and here. And I'd never heard of PEG before, PEG.
Mm-hmm. And her name is Margaret, actually. But okay.
Pardon me?
Her name is Margaret. Sorry.
Yeah, Maggie. Yeah. And so I'm learning a lot about your world. I knew about community access because Comcast 20 years ago used to have a really bad studio with really bad services for public access. And so I've watched CMAC really step in and fill a great gap. And I've really appreciated that in our community. I have heard a lot of talk about public access and government ties. I have not heard a lot of talk about education here. And I think that you guys need to really look at it. We're my university is a wonderful university. We have three centers, one the Center for Community Transformation, one called ALAS, which is Hispanic first-gen development, you know, dreamers, and that kind of, and we have another, it's called the Center for, no, it's the Peace and Conflict Resolution, CPACs, is what you know I'm talking about. And these are four social benefit centers that are run through the university. And those are the kinds of things I hear a lot of conversation about, but CMAC, I would encourage you guys to really investigate incorporating the story that they have to tell. Also, I want to encourage you guys, our university is a wonderful, it's very well recognized for certain arenas. The education, our educators program is stellar. Our business program is wonderful. But we don't have a real strong media program, honestly. I don't work in the academic side. Yeah. I work creating content for the university's marketing. So a collaboration that would help us build a stronger media program using your resources and tying it to the university's needs for class, room space, instruction.
So, you know, two quick things. I mean, you're right. I would say we do not have as strong a presence with universities nationally as we could. I think on a sort of a project by project and community by community basis, you have those partnerships. That's how they grow organically, right? Yeah, I mean, and so you'll see that, I mean, I think, you know, and actually in some instances you actually have centers that are located on university campuses. The key example of this is BronxNet in the Bronx, which is on the campus of Lehman College and is now actually going to two other college campuses in the community. So it is that kind of marriage of sort of community-based learning that I'm talking about. And I just sort of just underline that for everybody is that you've got common cause with an institution that cares about education in the community. And that's the place where the partnership lies, it seems to me, right? You guys should talk, you aren't talking already, but I think we have to be building those on the ground as well as having those conversations nationally and regionally.
I'm so glad he's here because we've reached out to Fresno Pacific 100 times and hit walls.
Yeah, I'm not aware of that.
Yeah. Well, to tell you the truth, we didn't know you existed. They don't talk about you for some reason. Okay.
Well, I mean,
now, we want to work with the university, and we work very strongly with all of the other schools in the area. So let's get together because there's a lot of things we would love to do for you.
Okay. And then, Jerry, you had a okay, we're going here. And I mean, I think we might be running out of time here. So we have 10:30 sessions here, but I want to.
So I'm from Fresno State.
Oh.
And I want to inform you that we actually have a very vibrant partnership. And there is a session at 10:30 that I'm on where we'll talk at least I'll be sharing about what we're doing from the educational perspective. So
yeah,
working with us.
And then one last sort of institutional layer to think about in terms of relationships, I'm really glad you're here, is think about community foundations. Not as a source of money, but as a source of ideas, right? And for you to be a partner with those community foundations to be able to push ideas forward in the community and a partner, really be seen as an indispensable partner in the future of the community, because those community foundations care about the long-term health of the local. Yeah. They should be your natural partners. Don't come to them with a tin cup. Come to them with the idea that you're inspired to co-create something good. Anyway, I think we're about out of time. Really, I thank you for the discussion, and I hope there are great things ahead for us here. So thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mike Wassenaar. That was... He'll be around all week. Stop him in the hallway. Ask him more questions. He has the answers and the direction. It is about time to get back to our next morning workshop. It'll begin at 10:30. If you look at your program, you'll know where to go. We will reconvene here for lunch, and we'll have a quick membership meeting. So enjoy, learn, come back. We will feast again if you haven't had enough food, and we'll go on. And remember, tonight, the Big Wave Awards Gala will be here. So enjoy, and thank you very much. Mike, it's a great plenary.